Ryan Reynolds here from Mint Mobile. With the price of just about everything going up during inflation, we thought we'd bring our prices down. So to help us, we brought in a reverse auctioneer, which is apparently a thing.
Mint Mobile Unlimited Premium Wireless. How to get 30, 30, how to get 30, how to get 20, 20, 20, how to get 20, 20, how to get 15, 15, 15, 15, just $15 a month? Sold!
Give it a try at mintmobile.com/switch.
$45 up front payment equivalent to $15 per month. New customers on first 3-month plan only. Taxes and fees extra. Speeds slower above 40 gigabytes in detail.
News team, assemble!
It's back and bigger than ever. It's the unofficial 40 from Soonerscoop.com. Now, here's the entire Soonerscoop crew. Kerry, Josh, Eddie, and
George.
All right, welcome back. It is the Unofficial 40 Podcast with Kerry, Josh, Eddie, and George. And we are here to soothe the savage beast that is the YouTube comment section. I don't think that's possible, by the way. I don't think there's any way. I've had to delete political commentary on there since last night, and Eddie will provide ours, I'm sure, at some point today. But welcome, gentlemen. I think maybe we should first go to George, because he's riled up today. I can already tell this morning.
No comment.
Getting after people, not happy with your mentions.
My mentions are just a disaster. The YouTube comments are worse, but it's amazing how many people, you have so many people on one side that want to tell you that everybody should be fired, they got to make a quarterback change.
Sure.
And then you have people on the other side that are like, well, this is what we wanted. We wanted a defense that you could win with your defense. Like, why are people complaining? And it's like, I'm over it.
By the way, I want to remind you guys that the Unofficial 40 is presented by the Oklahoma Zoological Society's 16th Annual Zoo Brew, presented by Byron's Liquor Warehouse at the OKC Zoo, Friday, September 27th. It's coming out. It's almost sold out. This thing will sell out. So go to ozsgiving.org for details and buy tickets today. We'll tell you more about it as we go along here in the show, but proud to have the Oklahoma Zoological Society presenting this podcast today. So, Josh, you know, George and Eddie have had their say a little bit. They've had their price. Of course, the recruiting report, I think, was more offensive line talk than recruiting report that you had on Monday, as some people pointed out.
There were some things that needed to be discussed.
But, George, can we at least say that calmed you down some, just having that rant on Monday, you know, the last 25 minutes?
I'm calm. I don't know how to feel. Like, I keep going back and forth. Like, I keep saying,
what to do with my hands.
Like, I watched the Aaron Murray video, which I thought was really telling.
It's very calming.
Yeah, it's very calming. But then you also are like, but they still are playing their fourth string center, and they still don't, you know, have anybody at wide receiver other than Deion Burks. And so it's like, it's this back and forth of optimism and then just straight depression on what could be a long season.
I think the biggest thing too offensively right now is because the injuries is a thing. Like, it's kind of like what Brent said on Tuesday. You can't avoid it, but it is part of the reason why this thing is not operating at the level that it needs to be. And then, like, when you say that, the direct response is, well, you go straight to offensive line, and it's like, well, whose fault is that? And I think that, like, that conversation we've had, we know why that looks like that. But at the same time, it's just like, I don't know, it feels like a cycle that you go through.
Well, it's a different conversation than how can they fix this current situation. Like, that's I think a larger conversation than, like, okay, how can they just get better this week?
Yeah.
You know, other than saying, well, they should have never been in this position in the first place. Well, they are. So it's like, there's no running
away from that right
yeah.
now.
It's one of those things that always happens, Josh, where I get it. People want things fixed. They want you to go to practice one week and come out the other side a completely different team. That's not reality. Reality is you have to incrementally get better on this offensive line. The young guys are going to incrementally get better. And the quarterback is going to incrementally get better with them. And I think the Aaron Murray thing that you talked about, you already brought up George. I think the one thing that continues to hit home for me, Josh, in that video is the one thing that he could not praise that needs to be fixed the most is the running game. If you don't have a running game, you don't have a chance to build some type of consistent offense. And whether that's getting rid of the RPO stuff, I know a lot of people have suggested that, but just getting a line to block up, you know, a play to where a guy can hit a hole is the number one issue with this offense. It's not Jackson Arnold.
Oh, it's absolutely not, guys. I mean, so the most direct comparison that I think you have for Jackson Arnold and what he's going through is Nico Iamaliava, who I chose to say his name and knew it was going to butcher it anyway.
That sounded good, though. That was really good.
Nico is getting 277 yards on the ground from his run game. Wow. Jackson's getting roughly half of that. And like that makes Nico's life so much easier. The things you're seeing in front of you, the way the safeties are going to have to attack the run, it changes everything. And that's born of, and this is what I talked about all offseason, guys. And I don't mean to single myself, but I know you guys felt the same way. This is why the Tennessee game was always scary to me, because Tennessee had the one thing, the one huge difference between those two teams is Tennessee returned a bunch of experience on the offensive line. They got some guys out of the portal that could really help them. Like the Hurd kid that we talked about all spring, they got him. And plus, they had a returning center with experience. They had several offensive linemen with experience. Now, I don't think they have some holes or some questions where OU maybe doesn't. But that's the difference, because Nico is being able to be eased into this. And, okay, let's let him grow. We're going to protect him. We can run when we need to. We can put him in, you know, good third down situations. That's the thing. Everybody keeps talking about third down and say, well, that's Seth Luttrell or that's Jackson Arnold. No, you're not going to complete many third downs if you're looking at third and seven plus all the time. That's just mathematically not going to work.
They're averaging, I think they've run the ball. I looked it up. I'm doing a deep dive on the offense this week. I think they've run the ball 25 times on first down this year, and they're averaging, I think, 2.5 yards per carry on those 25. I mean, like, that's automatically putting you in second and eight, and you're having to either throw the ball or you try to run it again, and you don't get yards again, and all of a sudden it's third and long. Like, that's the problem.
Josh, much like...
And that feels high. 2.5 feels higher than what I thought you were going to tell me, to be honest.
It's skewed a little bit because they did run... They had the Taylor Tatum runs at the end of the Temple game were on first down, and so was the Michael Hawkins run, and so those were their big chunk plays. If you took those out, it's even lower.
And I'm guilty of this because I'll watch during the game. You know, we have a stats feed in the press box, and, you know, it was always mind-blowing to me back in the Lincoln Riley days when their average per play yardage, because it would always be, sometimes it would be in double figures. Like, it was ridiculous.
And yeah, I think Baker 2017 team, I thought they averaged something crazy. I think it was a record, NCAA record.
Yeah.
I want to say it was like 7.8 or something like that.
Yeah, I mean, but, you know, they're around 4 or 5 yards a play. I mean, really about 4 yards a play. I'd have to go back and look at the last two games. But to me, that shows you how well an offense is running in the explosive plays you have, whether in the run game or the pass game. And it's just been far too low. And I'm not trying to start this, oh, well, it's not the Lincoln Riley. Of course, it's not the Lincoln Riley offense. I mean, it's not running like that. You don't have the experienced quarterbacks that you had then. The offensive line is pretty banged up and pretty bad at this point. But when that yards per play starts to increase, that's when you know this offense is starting to kind of get it figured out.
Sergeant and Mr. Smith, you're going to love this house.
Bunk beds in a closet?
There's no field manual for finding the right home. But when you do, USAA Homeowners Insurance can help protect it the right way. Restrictions apply.
They've only had three plays over 25 plus yards through two games. Jaleel Farouk's catch on the first possession, Brennan Thompson's catch this past week, and then I believe it was Sam Franklin.
Taylor Tatum had like a 31-yard run.
I thought that was Sam Franklin.
There's four. I think there's four, George, because Tatum had a 35-yard run and Sam had a 30-yard run in the Temple game.
Oh, I'm looking at just passing. My bad. I'm looking at, I clicked on the wrong thing. They've only had three passing plays of over 25 plus yards.
2017 team averaged 8.1 yards per play. That was the best in the country. The 2018 team averaged 8.4 yards per
play. What did they average last year? That was the best
in the country.
That's every time they snap the ball.
Last year, Oklahoma was number nine. They averaged 6.7 yards per carry or per play.
Yeah.
So I mean,
aspire to be better.
But yeah, I mean, it all starts with the run game. I mean, look, I understand people are going to say, well, Taylor Tatum's clearly been the most explosive back. He's also the guy that gets you in third and nine a lot because he misses a blitzer, lets a guy run free, doesn't get his, like, he's young. He's going to have those mistakes. I'm not saying he sucks and you can't play him. I'm just saying you got to pick your spots where you're going to play him. You need to have, Javonte Barnes playing a lot. And look, I'm not saying give up on Gavin Sawchuk because I'm sure most people would say, well, he sucks. He's not good. He's not doing anything. To me, Gavin Sawchuk, you play him more when the offensive line starts getting a little bit better.
Yeah, sure. And I think that you saw that at the end of last year. That offensive line was playing pretty well towards the end of it, weren't they, Josh?
They were. And Eddie, I think it goes to what Kerry's saying about Gavin Sawchuk. He is a little bit – he loves those cutback lanes. Like, he loves to stick his foot in the ground. Okay, I'm going to bounce to my secondary lane. I'm going to do that stuff. I don't think he is accepted. That's not going to work right now. And that's why Javonte Barnes looks better. Javonte Barnes hits everything like he's the Kool-Aid guy running through the wall. Like, I mean, that is the way he does it. And I know that makes people mad when he may not dance or break tackles the way people want him to. But for what they need right now, a guy to go slam out 3, 4, 5 yards when it's there, Javonte Barnes is their best option, and I don't think it's even close.
I would just say we probably haven't seen enough Sam Franklin to judge whether he would be good in that situation. But, yeah, I agree with that 100%.
I just want him to pick one guy and let him get a rhythm. And we said that a lot of times last year, and I think injuries kind of held them from doing that early in the season. But they're not injured at running back. Like, let's see some of these guys and, like, give, you know, Taylor Tatum two possessions in a row or Javonte Barnes, you know, 3 or 4 possessions or the entire first half. Like, I feel like part of the run game problems, yeah, the offensive line isn't blocking it well, but it's also hard as a running back to get in a rhythm when you're getting yanked every series.
Even in some of
there were, sorry, Eddie, real quick. There were some plays when I went through the idiot. There were some moments where it was well blocked up. There was room to run. And the guys, you know, and I think it could be what George is talking about, where you've got guys that are not there. They're not fully up to speed yet, and they're not seeing it like they normally would or like they were at the end of last year. And so guys are a little more hesitant and not hitting the hole like they should. Sawchuk had one where he really had a nice lane, and he just didn't see it in time. So it's not all the offensive line, but I do think there's something to – getting a rhythm at running back. And frankly, OU hasn't done that, you know, to any degree since Eric Gray left.
Yeah, and look, I think what it comes down to is, you know, what running back can identify a hole that may not be a big one and do it the best, and that looks to be Javonte Barnes, because vision is very important. As Eddie Radosovic can tell you, did you ever have Eddie, like, Little League football, like Pee Wee football, were you ever the running back ever?
No.
Give me a break.
No.
What? I mean, people change. I was a running back when I was young. Like,
Eddie
I
was never a running back.
I was never blessed with
quick feet. You know how this goes? Like,
feet.
Sometimes people are like, they're on track to be Olympic athletes. Like, they're the best long jumpers when they're like in the fifth grade, and then they grow, and then they become
no offense
gangly.
To Eddie, but I don't think any of us were on track to be Olympic athletes.
The problem ever. Is,
well, I might have been. I just never really competed in track and field, so I don't know.
I was on no offense to Eddie. What about Kerry and I? Like, what if we're offended by this, George?
I was on the track team. I just never competed in the events. I think I've told that story before.
Anyway,
I'd get out of school and then just not show up when they announced the event.
Just like OU's punt returners, people need better vision.
They do. And I have a place that they could go if they're interested in LASIK. All they got to do is go to Enjoy Vision. It's the best laser vision center in Oklahoma City, and it's not even close. Combination of mind-blowing technology, experienced eyeball surgeons, and exceptional patient care was life-changing for me. What the fine folks of Enjoy are doing for the unofficial 40 listeners, they're giving off $400 off LASIK. All you got to do is go to enjoywithme.com, use the promo code U40, that is N-J-O-Y OYWithMe.com and use the promo code U40 if you're so inclined and so interested. Enjoy vision. This is where you LASIK.
All right. Really appreciate enjoy being a part of things and going to be even a different, bigger part of things, I think, coming up soon as well with the YouTube channel. By the way, YouTube channel, we just passed 17,000 subscribers. That's big time. We kind of secretly set a goal at the end of the season, but Eddie's declared 34,000 the other day, so we're sticking with that.
Let's double it.
Let's just double it. But yeah, the great thing about YouTube is you know, you get Josh at Mondays with the recruiting report. Tuesdays you get the practice report after Brent Venables' press conference. You have the unofficial 40 audio format. We'll be going to video. I know people keep asking that question. When the new studio is ready, we'll be going to video. And then the family business coming up. We're interviewing Jordan Rogers today, SEC. He was on the call of the OU game last weekend. I didn't realize this about Jordan Rogers. One of the only people that actually married his girlfriend off of The Bachelor.
Correct.
You knew that fact?
I did.
I bet Tiffany makes you watch The Bachelor.
To her ever-living credit, she does not watch any of the reality TV. Tiffany watches almost no television, period. But she's never been a reality TV girl.
There's a lot of drama.
Be
right
like
now.
Dirty Jobs with Mike Rowe.
There's a lot of drama going on with The Bachelorette right now.
Why?
Is the Golden Bachelorette?
Well, it was the guy. There was like a guy that proposed to the girl. She said yes. And then like he basically ghosted her after the show, after they got engaged.
I kind of like that.
Yeah.
That's happened before, though, hasn't it?
Not like that. Not like where they got engaged and then he just literally stopped talking to her and was seen out at like different clubs with other women.
Like as soon as the cameras turned off, yes. He was just like, yeah, I'm done.
I'm out of here. This. Yeah. Yeah.
How do you know this, George?
I just follow along with the news.
You're just on the ride, Josh.
Okay.
I didn't watch.
You're a kept man now.
I used to watch The Bachelor and Bachelorette years ago. I haven't kept up with it, but I just saw it on my Twitter feed and kind of like went down the rabbit hole. Mm-hmm. Like, what happened?
I wonder
here?
What's happening here.
Yes, yeah. Because there seemed to be a lot of drama, and I do like that kind of drama.
Okay. So I don't know if we'll talk to. I don't know if. I mean, I'm sure he likes talking about the Bachelor stuff. I'd forgotten that Jesse Palmer was actually a contestant and the host now.
I have no idea.
Anyways,
he's
do you guys want to?
I knew.
Do you guys want to hear
one.
A crazy?
I didn't know Jordan Rogers was on it.
Do you guys want to hear a crazy stat?
Yeah.
So I've read I like this to. That. I read this to Eddie earlier. I got on a Pro Football Focus's grades, offensive grades, and I sometimes am a little weary with these grades just because I don't know how accurate some of these are, especially when it comes to offensive linemen. But I went to the center position and just looked at how the center how centers across the country have been graded. There have been 145 centers graded with 40 or more snaps, so minimum 40 snaps. Where do you think Josh Bates and Garen Hatchett rank out of those 145 centers in the country?
Josh just has his hand over his face right now.
I'm going to guess like bottom 15.
Like 142.
Garen Hatchett is last at 145. Josh Bates is 120th.
I mean, I would assume like everybody's like, Josh wants to bury your head, but find me somebody else that's going to play an entire game with a torn bicep.
Oh, I mean, that's the thing is.
Oh, yeah.
I don't blame Hatchett at all for being 145th. I mean, the guy was playing with one arm. But. You know, you'd hope Josh Bates would be a little higher, but at the same time, they never anticipated him playing a lot this year.
Yeah, and that's one of those injury things that Brent talked about yesterday, and he was pretty brutally honest about it. Like, ones are ones for a reason, twos are twos for a reason, and so on and so forth.
Yeah, we got a four starting.
Does Josh, just in terms of like Monday Morning Idiot and going back and watching the game, I don't think that everything is solved with Branson Hickman whenever he is to come back, but it's certainly a step in the right direction. And I don't know if you watched the practice report that George and I did on Tuesday, just in terms of that would give you a little bit more wiggle room if you want to move Jacob Sexton back out to tackle. You can get somebody else in there at guard, whether that be Ozaida or EPP or whoever. EPL.
Yeah,
I'm going to coin that.
I don't think there's any doubt. With Hickman, it's not just so much in that he is the best center available, which he is. He clearly is. But it makes you better at maybe two other positions. Like, left tackle gets better, right tackle gets better because Tarkan can just be there, stay there, And like we've talked about, and like Brent talked about in the press conference, develop that cohesion, develop the, you know, just everybody working in sync together. And I think that's huge. And again, guys, I have talked to people over and over again. Keith Ozida feels like one of those guys that just needs time. If they can just get him on the field, let him get some snaps. I know Eddie Pierre-Louis, the same thing. Like those are two of their most talented offensive linemen. They can't get them on the field right now because they can't put those young guys in there next to a center that doesn't really know what he's doing yet.
Yeah, and that probably means that anybody else is not the answer right now. I mean, whether it's Eugene Brooks or whoever you want to try and put in there, they're not a better answer than Josh Bates, regardless if they're more talented or not. If they do not know the calls on the offensive line and who to go to and how to read this formation, you're never going to get your other young talent in there with him. So I get that part, and I think people need to realize that part. I'd love to see kind of a, I think Gabe might even be doing it some, but just kind of an Aaron Murray type breakdown of the offensive line and what they're not doing right, what they're reading wrong, or and
YouTube, I know, have a time limit on how long videos can be.
I don't think so. I mean, I've seen those ones where it's like, here's 10 straight hours of, you know, the worst noise in the world or whatever.
It's just, I don't know. I'm somewhere between. Like, obviously, it can be fixed. I just, the run game thing just really doesn't make a whole lot of sense to me. I feel like there's things that they could do to help everybody out. I don't understand how they just can't move guys, especially the competition that they play.
Think you know the Brooks Ghost? Think again. Introducing the all-new, better-than-ever Ghost 16. Now with nitrogen-infused cushioning for lightweight, supreme softness that feels good every step, every street, every single day. So go ahead, take your daily joyride in the all-new nitrogen-infused Ghost 16. It'll turn your everyday miles into everyday endorphins. Let's run there. Head to brooksrunning.com to learn more.
Well, I mean, being pass-heavy just in your calls is the first thing. I mean, you go back to that game. What was it, like 18 passes to 7 handoffs to running backs in the first half, I think?
Yeah.
Like, they've got to,
but again, like,
at least trust that you can, you know, get some balance in your offense, because as we saw, I mean, Jackson, we talked about Jackson Arnold doesn't have as many options at receiver as he would like to have. Now, George, you were on the call, the teleconference call, the SEC teleconference call, where you asked Brent Nick Anderson.
I think they want to be balanced, but when you're in second and 10 every time or third and long, you can't run the ball. Go ahead, George.
I agree with Eddie. I think it's tough to have the balance. Nick Anderson, it's, you know, Brent said that he practiced on Tuesday. He's supposed to practice again today, so that's good news. He didn't really say if he'll be available on Saturday. He said they're hopeful, whatever that means. I think there's a lot of frustration inside the building with the injury stuff. I thought Brent's comments yesterday were pretty interesting when he talked about
the trainers,
the trainers, and calling them Dr. Death. So we'll see if Nick can give it a go. I know that there's a lot of people that think Nick can go. So I will be interested to see if he gives it a go.
And it's also the way that Brent talked about it yesterday. I almost wonder if it's a thing that Nick's wanted to go, but he's not getting cleared.
I've heard that as well. That Nick, we heard that before the opener.
Sure.
That Nick wanted to play.
Yeah. I don't think
Have we heard anything on Andrell? I'm sorry, Eddie.
No, go ahead.
He's the one. Was there any verdict on why he played week one and not week two?
I don't know, and Eddie, you might have a better perspective on this. I haven't asked Brent, so I don't really know for certain, but just watching him in warmups last week, it just doesn't seem like he is full speed. Like, he does not look like somebody who is prepared to go out there and run full routes.
I mean, he looks like somebody who's just been medically cleared. Like, there's rust, there's no confidence, whether it's in his knee, that it's okay. It's pretty clear that, not that he's a shell of himself, but he just looks like a guy that's just not quite ready. And whether that's mental, physical, whatever, It's a combination of all of it. But for him to for them to try and put him out there in the first game and then not even use him in the second game kind of makes me feel like there's probably been a little bit of regression at practice over the last, you know, couple of weeks.
I think the Javonte Barnes thing has really affected the way that I look at people coming back from injury and just getting the confidence back to be able to let it go rather than, you know, just going out there and saying, yeah, I feel fine and not being able to get over that little mental hump.
Like you might be like a serial killer if it's that easy.
I would prefer serial killers on a football team.
That's going to affect your depth chart from week to week.
I mean, it should. People don't talk about Wayne Gacy at outside linebacker enough.
I'm thinking Jeffrey Dahmer would not cut it on the football.
Well, he's got the mask on. I mean, how much damage could Dahmer really do?
That's true.
By the way,
did he eat cats?
No, he ate people. He ate neighbors.
I was just wondering.
Eddie getting his debate takes in.
Although you might have heard that on the debates last night. I don't know. A lot of accusations being thrown around. By the way, the Oklahoma Zoological Society 16th Annual Zoo Brew presented by Byron's Liquor Warehouse at the OKC Zoo is Friday, September 27th.
It's back! The Oklahoma Zoological Society's 16th Annual Zoo Brew, presented by Byron's Liquor Warehouse at the OKC Zoo, Friday, September 27th. Craft beer fans age 21 and older will enjoy a variety of tastings from the finest breweries in Oklahoma, as well as wineries and distilleries. Gates open at 6 p.m. Tickets will sell out. Visit ozsgiving.org for details or to buy tickets today. Zoo Brew at the OKC Zoo, Friday, September 27th.
The Oklahoma City Zoo, presenting sponsor of the Unofficial 40 this week. Remember, ozsgiving.org for all the details and to buy your tickets. It's September 27th. That's a Friday, 6 o'clock. They will sell out if they haven't already. So go check it out. A great event. A lot of people. Go see the red pandas, man. I really want to go see the red pandas. I need to get up there. Okay. Thanks to the OKC Zoo. And have fun, guys, going out there and checking out the animals. Okay, so, you know, Brent was, I don't know, Monday it was, I would say, Tuesday, I'd say it was, I don't know, facing the firing line a little bit for Brent. I mean, people will want to say, I know you've seen comments like, you guys don't ask tough enough questions. I thought the questions were direct. They addressed, you know, the issues. And to be honest, I mean, I thought Brent handled it pretty well. I mean, I know there's some people that's like, I don't want any excuses. I don't care about injuries. Well, you're not living in reality. That's just reality. There are injuries that are affecting the performance of this team. But I don't know, George, how did you kind of think just the overall tone of the press conference went and how Brent handled it?
I thought he was pretty honest. Again, a lot of people don't want to hear the excuses, but I think that it's a pretty valid excuse when you think about the injuries that they have suffered up front and just the inexperience with the offense. But, you know, I think that Brent's frustrated, to be honest, and I don't know why he wouldn't be. Like, he gets it. He's not an idiot. Like, yeah. He's not blind to the issues that they're facing right now and what's to come with this schedule. And I also think that they're taking Tulane very seriously. Like, this is a team
they
that should
be.
Well, and yeah, and but Brent said on his coach's show on Monday that he believes that this skill group that they're about to face in Tulane, from quarterback, wide receiver, running back, tight end, is one of the best groups, if not the best group, they're going to face all season. Now, I don't know how much of that is just coach speak, but you look at some of the dudes that Tulane has, I think that they're definitely taking this pretty seriously. I do think when you look at what Kansas State was able to do against Tulane's defense, OU's got to figure out how to run the ball in this game.
Yeah, they ran the ball really well.
Yes, and so that to me is where I'm like, they have got to find a way to get that running game going. We talked about that earlier. But I think overall Brent is frustrated, but he's also very honest. I thought he was very honest with what the issues are. And he's not going to – I saw some people complaining, like, you know, he didn't say how they're going to fix it. And it's like, well, what – I mean, he's not going to get up there and be like, well, this week instead of running inside zone insert or whatever, we're going to run more outside zone and move the pocket. Like, he's not going to get up there and tell you exactly what they're going to do.
Yeah, and I'd love to, you know, be at some of the practices just to see what they're doing, because they're so banged up. It's like, how much inside drill can you really do to develop, you know, cohesion on that offensive line and really hammer home the running game? It's just, it's one of those things, like, you're kind of in a catch-22. It's like, do you practice these guys harder to get them to develop and to build some toughness on the offensive line? Or do you take it back until guys can get healthy? You know, maybe that's the most important thing. It's just, I think as a coach, that's probably one of the toughest things to go through, is just figuring out how to practice these guys to make them better, you know, when they've had so many injuries.
Yeah, and he talked about they doing more good-on-good work. I don't know if that necessarily means they're playing, you know, first-team offense versus first-team defense in practice and team stuff. Like, I think he means more like, you know, our freshman wide receivers are going against Woody Washington and Des Malone and Kenai Walker in, you know, one-on-one passing drills and working on things like I don't think they're doing first string versus first string in team practice. I don't know. Maybe I'm wrong, but I took that more as like in certain reps, they're doing more good on good to help some of these younger guys.
I generally, you know, just knowing Brent and, you know, the systems he's been in and covering him, I think good on good to him means you have the ones versus the ones going against each other in practice when you go through team.
Maybe. I don't know. I don't know if it's a smart idea to have Dominic Williams going up against Josh Bates right now, who's dealing with an injury, but I don't know.
But it might be good if Dominic Williams is going up against Heath Ozaida and.
Yes.
And who else? EPL. I mean.
Right. I just don't. I don't know really what he meant by that. You know, I don't really know. I don't know the answer.
It means one on ones.
Yeah.
One versus ones, I mean. All right, defensively, you know, it's kind of, nobody's really talked a whole lot about it, but there's no panic behind the defense. But I think I have seen, Josh, a lot of people asking the question, like, how far can just the defense take this team? Because you watch the Houston game, and as well as that defensive played, they were tired at the end of it. I mean, it was, I don't know how you guys felt, Eddie down on the field, George in the press box. I could feel how tired that team was in the press box, personally.
Played a lot of snaps. A
lot of snaps. And they do rotate a lot of guys, but it just shows you, even though they rotate guys on the defensive line and the secondary, everybody, if your offense and time of possession kind of evened itself out almost, but it was like 31-17 at one point in that game. And it just can't continue week after week. Josh, I would think, as good as this defense is playing, if you don't get some help from the offense, they're going to start giving up more and more plays. You're going to start seeing more busts in the secondary. You're going to see some guys miss tackles. Like, at some point, this kind of starts to pile on to the defense and gets frustrating for them too, right?
I think Eddie and I kind of talked about, I mean, and George was with it too, but we were talking about it in the report, how there's this conception now of like, oh, well, the offense isn't as good, but the defense, we've just, you know, OU's just flipped the sides of the script. And I'm like, those offenses were historic. Like we were talking about earlier, they were doing things nobody was doing. This defense is good. It's a really good unit. I get that OU fans don't have a concept of like the difference between a good defense and a great defense. It's all just a hell of a lot better than it has been. And that's great. But this isn't a defense that's going to go win you games 14-10 against Tennessee or Georgia or Texas or something like that. They're good. They'll keep you in a game if you're playing some level of functional offense. But if you're going to screw around and not be, you know, and not have anything going offensively, they're going to break down at some point. They're not that group. They're not so good that they can just kind of dictate the terms to whatever offense they're playing. That's not how this is going to be. And they've missed some tackles. There's been some stuff they could work on. I don't think it's been perfect by any stretch, but I mean, I agree. It's a good unit, but I think people have to be careful of saying, oh, it's going to be fine. The defense has got it. The defense is good. It's a top 20 defense. It's not a top 5 defense to what I've seen so far.
And I would also say, like, the way that they're headed, with the way that they're recruiting, with the way that they're bringing in defensive linemen, it does have a chance. Like, the trajectory of the thing, they have a chance to be elite
at some point over the next however many years. But to sit here and say that, like, as fantastic as Grayson Holton's been, and I would love to be wrong about this, but as good as he's been, I don't think that when you start playing Tennessee and, you know, the list goes on and on with all the SEC teams, that all of a sudden, if he can keep that level of play against some of these better offensive lines, I'd be more than happy to have that conversation. Like, I was thinking about this, and I asked George the other day when we were sitting around here at the office, Josh, for you, and as good as Danny was, he was fantastic at times last year. Saturday was like the first time that it was like, he's kind of taking this game over. Like, Danny Stutzman is making every single play, and he's not just making the play. It's almost like he's a step ahead of everybody else. That was the first time that I had thought about that for an OU defender, maybe since I've ever covered the team.
In the Hot 11 I put out this week, I said something similar. I was like, this is a different level of Danny Stutzman than we've seen before. What he did in this game, some of it was like, okay, he studied the tape. He knew, you know, what he was looking at. He was ready for this, you know, from this motion, they're going to do this. Like, he was prepared. And then some of it was like, that's just instinct. Like, that's just a guy that really knows what, you know, he's reading blocks well. He's seeing everything before it happens. So I agree. To me, I thought the guy on the defense last year that would do that at times was Billy. I thought Billy was the only guy on that defense that I saw at times really be, oh, he's clearly the best player on this field. Like, there's not really any question. I haven't seen Billy go to that place yet, but Danny, I don't think it was even close, was the best player on the field against Houston by about a mile.
They need some more pick sixes from Billy this year. They need to have some of those for some points. I was also going to say, Josh, I wanted to ask you, where do you think this offense, I think right now, where are they ranked in S&P Plus? Do you know, Eddie?
Offensively? I can find out real quick.
I think 36, they're I think, is what I saw the other day when I looked.
You said 36th?
Yeah.
Wow, that's
like that.
A lot higher than I anticipated. That's probably because
someone... Same.
But... they're gonna play better defenses. If this offense can finish top 40 and SP plus.
People are gonna be pissed.
It just sounds better. S&P plus.
Well, there is an S&P plus.
I know. Anyways,
you dodged the question in the mailbag this week.
I did. Well, I had 100
about
questions.
About the Dow.
Unbelievable. 100 questions. I had a question about the stock market affecting NIL, and I was just like, "What are we doing, people?" Anyways, Josh, if the offense can finish, I don't even top 50 SP plus and score around 30 points a game, you know, total yards somewhere top 50, like how many games do you think OU can win if they can just get there, just be basically an average offense?
Real quick, SP plus, OU overall rating 15.6, currently number 19 in the country, 36th, as you said, in offense, 16th in defense, 52nd in special teams.
George, the closest comp to that, if you go back and look at the 2024 stuff, just as a kind of a baseline idea of what you're talking about there, that's basically what Utah did last year. They were like 35th or 38th or something in offense, 33rd in offense and 12th in defense. So probably a little higher than what you're talking about, and against obviously a good schedule, but not what OU's staring at this year. So I mean, if you're in those places, you're probably talking... 8-4 is probably the ceiling, would be my guess. I would think you're looking at more like 7-5. Because you're just going to, if you're now, I guess you could argue it this way. They have been so piss poor the first 2 weeks to climb or to gain, or, you know, to be better by the end of the year would have mean they would have to have had some pretty good games against some pretty good defenses. So maybe you can take some silver lining in that. In that, okay, Conley's got him at 36th after not doing much against Houston and Temple. So how do they move up? They would have to be pretty strong against some good defenses. So I don't know, but again, I would think you're probably looking at 7-5 in that situation. Which, guys, I'll be perfectly honest, based on what the offense is doing right now and the projection of, you know, when Jahlil Farouk can be back, what we don't know about Branson Hickman, what we don't know about Jake Taylor, like all these key injuries,
I don't think 7-5 is the worst case scenario, guys. I hate to say that, but I mean, there are monsters on the rest of the schedule.
It's amazing that Utah did that with a backup quarterback for 10 games.
That is crazy. I was going to say, I think they need to get to the bye week at 4-1. If they can get to the bye week at 4-1, you know, that would entail either winning against Tennessee at home, which I don't think any of us are confident about right now, or winning at Auburn, and then also, you know, beating a good Tulane team this weekend. If you can do that, get to 4-1 by the bye week, maybe you get healthy. And I know what
we were saying that though in the preseason, or at least I was.
I was saying they should be 5-0, but Tennessee looks a lot better than I anticipated, and OU looks a lot worse than I anticipated.
I still think Auburn's going to be incredibly tough, even despite what they did last weekend.
I know. But my point is,
Saturday's going
to
be tough.
My point is, if you can get to 4-1 by the bye week, you can get to that 7 or 8 win mark this season, because I look at Texas and I know what Texas is doing, but I also know that that game is just a crazy game every year, and maybe you can squeak out and win that game. But I look at Tennessee, Texas, Ole Miss, and Alabama. I don't know if you can win those games. It's going to take an incredible effort to win one of those games, I think. But the other games, I still look at as they can win that. Now, that doesn't mean that they're going to, but I feel like they can beat Auburn. I still think that they could beat a Missouri. It's going to take a really good effort, but I think they could beat them. I think they can beat LSU, who I think has been underwhelming so far this year. And then South Carolina, who I know played really well this last week against Kentucky. I also don't know how good Kentucky is. They might get beat by 60 this weekend by Georgia. And then obviously Maine. So I don't know. We're getting ahead of ourselves. They need to go beat Tulane and just build some confidence this weekend. But it's definitely, the first couple of weeks have made me rethink and reassess kind of what the season should look like.
Yeah, you have to. I think you'd be a little bit out of your mind if you didn't. If we were just sitting around and saying everything's fine. It is, you know, and we'll see. Kind of, I'm somewhat interested in seeing what Missouri does this weekend against Boston College. I know that game's in Columbia, but at the same time, I don't know. It's kind of different. Boston College looks somewhat decent. We'll see. I don't know. The whole thing this weekend is going to be interesting.
Yeah. By the way, I want to tell you guys about the Game Time app. GameTime.co is the web address. But once you go check out the Game Time app, George, I know you use it a lot for. Tell me, what kind of deals are we getting on the Game Time app right now for OU Tulane? Because I would imagine a lot of Tulane people wouldn't mind just driving down here to get out of the harm's way of the hurricane right now.
You can get tickets for $42 right now on the Game Time app. So you definitely need to go check that out. I'm looking here too. You can get like section 32, that's where my parents sit, mm-hmm. about 20 rows up, $84.
Nice. By the way, Game Time, their curation makes it easier to save more on sports, concerts, comedy, theater, etc. All-in pricing, toggling. You can toggle the feature that shows the total up front with no surprise fees at checkout. Just go download the Game Time app, create an account, and use code ON3 for $20 off your first purchase. Terms do apply. That is code ON3, the number 3, for $20 off your first purchase. Terms apply on the Game Time app. And as I said, go to GameTime.co or just go to the App Store and download that app. Again, create that account, redeem code ON3 for $20 off. Terms do apply. And just a great ticket company. It's a great supporter of the podcast. So appreciate Game Time being a part of this whole thing.
Do you guys think that the kind of the underrated storyline going into this week, and I know like when the opening line came out, I know he's a 14-point favorite, a lot of people's eyeballs went like, holy shit, that's a lot of points. At the same time, as good as Darian Mintz has been for Tulane, it's going to be interesting. Like, if OU can force turnovers this weekend, which I think that they will, I think basically over the last 24 games, they've done it in, I think, 22 of the last 24 or 23 of the last 24. It seems like that's just kind of an underlying storyline that hasn't really been talked. Everybody's talking around here, obviously, about Jackson, can the offense bounce back, all that kind of stuff. I just find the OU defense matchup against Tulane and Darian Mensah and Mario Williams to be, I don't know, it's kind of fascinating.
I think it is fascinating because if Oklahoma, like you said, we talk a lot about the offense, but if Oklahoma is going to win games this year. I think the defense can really help them with the turnovers and setting up maybe some short fields and things like that, putting them in a position to succeed. So, and maybe even, you know, Kansas State returned, what was that, like a 50-yard fumble for a touchdown last week. I'm not saying that OU is going to be able to do that this week, but if they could get a defensive touchdown, I think that that would be obviously welcomed.
Well, and there's not a whole lot of concern defensively from an injury perspective, but there is some. I mean, Gentry Williams, you know, came into the game, left the game. You had Peyton Bowen on a bike trying to stay loose the entire time. I'm trying to think of anybody else that just, you know, Woody Spears was Jennings, back and did good.
Spears Jennings and Kip Lewis each got banged up, but both came back into the game.
And played extremely well when they came back in.
Spears Jennings has been... Danny and Billy have been great. I wonder if through two games, Spears Jennings hasn't been maybe their best player so far defensively. Like, he just has been really, really good. I don't know. You could say that about so many guys. Like, Grayson Halton's probably in that conversation, too.
He's kind of like in that next level. I would put those three in a little bit of a separate category, and then Grayson Halton's kind of... And they're not trailing very far, right?
Yeah.
George, were you over there when Grayson was being interviewed Monday?
I was not.
Eddie, were you over there?
No, Bob was.
Man. Picked the wrong guys to be on the pod this week, I guess. No, I'm just kidding. I mean, here's the thing about Grayson. You guys have talked to him post-game especially. Yeah, the feeling that I get from him is that he has been a guy. Like, he's flashed, and we've all been impressed by him. But I get the feeling like he's grown up a lot.
Yeah.
Like, he is – he's probably – comes off as probably a fun-loving, you know, guy in the locker room, doesn't take things too seriously. But it seems like he's realized, like, okay, I'm becoming dependent on around here. And – I can make plays with the guys that are in front of me. When you have a Dominic Williams and you have a Jaden Jackson that are up there just pounding against guys and I get to come into the game, like, it's no longer for him. It seems like his mentality has shifted from, I'm just a guy that's going to go out there and try and make some plays, to I get to go into the game and I'm going to get after somebody.
He's their best pass rusher right now.
Yeah.
I mean, he's been phenomenal.
It is interesting.
Speaking of that, George... With that on that final series, did you guys think it was interesting that PJ Adebaraway was out there in their pass rush specialty?
Thought it was very
really interesting. Didn't see the field before.
It's six snaps.
It's interesting too because they did that a lot last year in late game situations where even I remember against Texas, he didn't play like the whole game, and all of a sudden he's in at the very end. I think that Josh might be one of those things where he's just kind of an athlete and he's also really lengthy. Maybe he can get his hands up, knock a ball down, or if the quarterback escapes, like, he's just a superior athlete. I think that maybe that's the thought process, but
it was PJ on one side and then R. Mason on the other, correct?
Yes. Yeah. So, like, I don't know. I mean, I also think Trace Ford has played really well at the edge, like, surprisingly well.
Have you been surprised that we haven't seen more flashes from R. Mason? I mean, he's done some good things.
I think R. Mason's been fantastic.
I think he's really close to making some big plays. I think
he's done some good things, and he's been in the backfield, but just breaking through and being that guy that, like, you know, gets a, you know, is close to a couple sacks a game. We haven't seen that yet.
Josh, we talked about it about it after the Temple game, but the play that he made that I think ended up being a 1 yard loss was incredible, mm-hmm. coming down from the outside.
He really is, and I would caution anybody out there that's listening. It's like, man, they're not getting pressure from the ends. Don't let that Houston game influence your opinion on that too much. There was such a clear identity. Like, Houston was not going to allow Oklahoma to put them behind the sticks. They had a clear plan what they were going to do offensively. Like, guys, even on those final two drives, Houston had a lot of trouble being like, okay, we're going to go down the field here. We're going to give ourselves some time to they wouldn't do it. And I heard Jordan Rogers say it on the broadcast, and I was saying the same thing. Like, OU would trade 5 yards for 5 seconds every single snap you want to do it, Houston. Like, that's fine. Do that. And it was probably the only thing during the game that I saw from that offense and Willie Fritz and the whole thing where I was like, guys, this isn't going to do it. This isn't going to get you where you need to go. And they were just – it was like they'd almost beaten it too deeply into Donovan Smith's head that he didn't realize you've got 35 seconds, man. You're going to have to challenge downfield.
By the way,
fumble.
By the way, the two highest graded defensive players from Oklahoma right now, according to Pro Football Focus, are Robert Spears Jennings and Grayson Holton.
Damn.
That makes sense. Yeah. I mean, you just kind of pointed
that out.
Did you
see Danny's score from Houston?
I have not. I'm looking
at his 67.
That's crazy. Then that's why.
What are you watching?
The Pro Football Focus stuff, like, I use it to a degree, and then I'm like, is this really accurate?
And they're doing it off of television tape for the most part. Yeah. So. Mm-hmm.
I mostly use it for the snap counts, which are always interesting.
Yeah, I mean, look, it was nice to see Kip Lewis back out there because it looked like it could have been a shoulder thing, but maybe it was just a stinger. But yeah, I mean, I thought it was interesting. We saw Danny off and Kobe McKenzie on fairly early in the game, too.
Yeah, supposedly I didn't catch it during the game, but supposedly Danny was not happy about that.
Really?
He does not want to come off the field.
I love it.
They did it. They took him out some in the third and fourth quarter, too. Yeah. And I think it was because in Brent and Allie's head, they were like, we're going to have to come up with some late game stops. Let's give Danny a breather before we have to go out there for the last 8 minutes of the game.
But I will say that when he's come off the field, they obviously are better with him on the field. But I think Kobe's playing pretty well right now.
They've got to be pretty happy with that whole crew. Like, I feel like that whole unit is playing pretty good football right now. And I will say, Danny is the linebacker from every football movie ever made. Like, he is that guy. Like Allie was talking about, he came over, I'm on fire, coach. Like, that's a line from a movie. That's not something I've ever heard.
Not only a linebacker, but like also the guy from the program that finds out he made first team and smashes his head into the window of the truck.
Latimer?
Yeah.
Can he play wide receiver?
Just have him play both ways. Travis Hunter's doing it. Why can't Danny play linebacker and center?
I did mention to you guys a couple weeks ago, kind of jokingly, like, well, maybe they should just move Billy Bowman to wide receiver. Jacoby Johnson.
I got to see him field some punts.
I had somebody ask me if Jacoby Johnson should be moved over, and I was like, it'd be crazy. I mean, if they can't get these guys ready,
he played a ton of snaps at corner, Jacoby Johnson. I mean, that's got to be the most he's ever played in the game.
I can look.
I will say, like, and we haven't mentioned him, and it's usually a good thing when a cornerback isn't mentioned, but I thought Woody Washington, the two defensive pass interference calls were absolutely atrocious.
The interception
was fantastic. Yeah. That was a great play.
It was textbook.
I can see the other one a little bit because he's running up the back of the – like, I get it. Like, I could get how that call gets made. I think it's wrong, but I get it.
The receiver fell down, though, didn't he?
He did, but he's trying to get back up. Yeah. And as he does, Woody's on his back. Like, I don't think I'd throw the flag, but I get it. The interception's just terrible. It's just a terrible call.
Jacoby Johnson played 19 snaps.
Is that it?
How many defensive snaps were there?
Oh, that's a good question. 65?
69.
That's crazy that when we talk about like the time of possession and OU and Houston basically had the exact same number of plays.
And that's one thing I think OU can do better at is controlling the clock. And I get it. When you have six of your 12 possessions, you go three and out, it's hard to control.
Well, it was a 20-yard drive, but it was like 12 plays or something like that, or nine?
Houston. Yeah, Houston did. But for OU offensively, I think that they can slow some of the tempo stuff down and just play a little game control. Like, I think that's one thing. I'm not saying get conservative, but let that play clock roll a little bit so your defense isn't having to get out there immediately, even if it is a three and out.
All right, we're going to have the game day preview coming up on the YouTube channel tomorrow, so we'll get more into what the players had to say this week. Josh, let's hit on, let's start with Cortez Mills. I mean, we've talked about him quite a bit this week. Any new developments there? Have you heard any scuttlebutt about, you know, this affecting his relationship with OU? Because I know last time you spoke on it, you really didn't know if it was going to cause a rift.
Yeah, I've talked to a few people. Carrie, if you want to take your time posting this, that's going to be fine because I have not put this up in Woke yet. But that's got to happen. My impression, I don't get the feeling that Oklahoma has chosen to drop Cortez Mills. That's not what I think. Do I think they're currently under the impression he's a commitment? No, I don't. I think this is what we've seen. I think they are going by their methodology. And the only one time I can remember them really
not doing it this way, and that was Colton Vosick, and that was, you know, his the whole thing with Texas Legacy, and his parents had season tickets and the whole thing. And the one time they didn't do it, obviously it didn't go their way, so maybe they just said never again. I don't know that answer yet. But my impression is that that's not the way Oklahoma's currently looking at him. I don't want to say that definitively, but I've talked to a few people that make me think that's the case.
Now, hold on. Let's clarify this. You're not saying that OU has dropped him.
No.
As a recruitable athlete, just that they are moving forward saying if we see something else or someone we find interest from someone, and that's a spot that we now consider to be open.
That is my understanding. I don't think it's a – I think Oklahoma loves Cortez Mills. They'd love him to be part of the class and think he is really talented. To me, of the five guys committed, I think he and Elijah Thomas are the two that kind of stick out for me from everybody else. I think they are truly difference-making receivers. I've said before, Cortez has some CeeDee Lamb stuff in there. Like, I mean, he does some stuff that is pretty special. And he is – if I'm almost certain, is the highest ranked of the five guys committed. So, again, I do not know anything about, you know, I've heard people say, oh, they dropped him. I have not been told that. I do think they are, I think they're in the process now of, do they continue to pursue him? Do they go after another receiver? Do they use that scholarship elsewhere and see, hey, maybe there's another guy out there that could fill this spot? But I think the easiest way to think of it, you know, for those that are still kind of confused about it, as it looks on every recruiting site out there, Oklahoma has 23 commitments and five wide receivers committed. I think Oklahoma sees it as 22-4. Like, that would be the easiest way to do that and kind of explain, I think, the way they're looking at their board.
Hypothetically, if Oklahoma were looking around and say that they were going to take somebody else outside of Cortez Mills, are there some names that come immediately to mind? Would you go back and holler at Andrew Marsh? Would you go back to some places that maybe they've been before? Or are there some other guys maybe that, hey, he's kind of started out, had a really good senior season so far, and maybe you look into them?
I definitely – Andrew Marsh, just because it was kind of Cortez or Andrew.
Sure.
Like, and I think Oklahoma kind of had to make that call. That's one that makes some sense. And, again, I mean – people will be like, well, why would a wide receiver want to come play in this offense? Well, look what Michigan's doing. Like, I don't think Andrew Marsh is any more in love with what he's seeing on tape from Michigan than he would be from Oklahoma. So I think that's an interesting one. Dalen McCutcheon is a guy that I think Oklahoma was in really good shape for as they kind of walked, you know, kind of the same deal. They kind of focus on some other guys. He's currently committed to Florida State, another school that obviously is having some of their own problems. My general feeling and the thing that I wonder about is if you see maybe Oklahoma pivot to a different position. Like, maybe, okay, this is how you get a second tight end in the class, or you could look at it a lot of different ways. But I could see them saying, hey, we've got bigger needs, and we've got some other guys that we've been in on a little longer. I know there have been it seems like there's been some more and more interest in, like, linebackers, edge type of guys. Like, I hear a lot of that kind of chatter. So maybe that's where you see that go. But, again, I have not heard anybody's name come up and say, oh, yeah, that's the guy. That's where they're going to go. So we'll kind of have to watch and see if anything changes.
So you do think that they could just drop that receiver scholarship and use it at a different position?
It's possible. It's definitely possible. The five, I think, was just like, well, this is so good. You know, they yeah. like all those guys a lot. It's not anybody, there's no one that they just like, well, we're just kind of taking him. Like, that's a really good wide receiver class, pretty solid from top to bottom. But I don't know if they feel like they could go out now and find a guy that's as valuable to the 85 as they could go find a guy at safety or linebacker or defensive line.
The news came, I think it was at the end of last week or at the beginning of this week. Kirsten Jones did commit to Nebraska. I guess it would have been at the beginning of this week off the heels of his visit to Lincoln in the Nebraska-Colorado game. Is that as much of just, it's really not much of a surprise?
Hey, guys, it's what we talked about. Sure. When he said he wanted to wait a couple weeks into the season, our immediate response was, I think he wants to see what Nebraska looks like. He wants to see if Nebraska's for real. And then they went out and put it on Colorado, and you know, it looks like they've got maybe a guy in Dylan Raiola at quarterback. And obviously that defense has been very good for the last 2 years now. I mean, that looks like they've got that figured out. So again, this is a guy, he's got a lot of connections to the program, you know, family within the program, that kind of stuff. So like, it was always going to be a tough hill to climb. That's the thing. Like, so what does OU do? And again, that's where this Cortez Mills thing kind of ties in as well. Like I said, I'm hearing a lot of talk of linebacker, edge, that kind of stuff. Well, is that a reaction to Oklahoma maybe thinking they've got another scholarship opening up, or is that simply a replacement for Christian Jones? I don't know that answer yet. We'll have to kind of, you know, keep talking to people and figuring things out. But I do think that they want another linebacker. I think they need one. At wide receiver, I think you could take it or leave it. I don't think that's a must that you have to do. To have one linebacker, you know, in this class with Marcus James from Carl Albert, who I think is a good one with some potential, but to follow two straight years of one linebacker in each of your recruiting classes, I don't think that's what they want to do. And again, I think that's something that they may plan to rectify, whether it's in recruiting or through the portal.
Yeah. And I would just also add, just in terms of next year's linebacker unit or whatever you want to call it, like on Saturday, I just noticed that he might have been out there on crutches on the Temple game too, but Phil Picotti on crutches, it looks like he had the surgery to, you know, fix his knee issues. So I don't know. It kind of does get a little bit, not fearful, but you got Kip, you got Kobe coming back. It'll be interesting. Lewis Carter obviously showed a little bit of a flash.
I do think Phil Picciotti is done for the season. I don't know if we've mentioned that.
Yeah.
He's been out on crutches.
He just mentioned that.
Literally just said that.
Yeah. Sorry. I was
texting. What were you reading?
Just looking at some stuff on the Twitterverse.
Interesting.
There's nothing better than
you read 9/11 conspiracy stuff, George. Is that what's happening today? Just showed up. You fell down a rabbit hole, didn't you?
No.
Eddie, would you like to talk about linebacker injuries?
It can happen. It can happen, Josh. No, it's. I did want to throw out the Christian Jones stuff there, though. I was really proud of myself. Didn't say one thing about it on radio this morning. It is going to be interesting. Anything else out there? Just in terms of, I know that we did the recruiting report on Monday. Highlighting Ryder Mix, highlighting Jordan Deck. Cortland Guillory's super, super, super interesting to me. And then, you know, obviously we talked about CJ Nixon out at Weatherford.
Yeah, you've got some guys really off to a strong start. You know, Trent Wilson had like four tackles for loss in his season opener against a team from Virginia that, if I'm not mistaken, was either a state finalist or a state champion last year. So, I mean, not just like nobodies. Like, he played a pretty good team. And they, you know, they came up a little short, but I think they lost 20-17 or something along those lines. But really, really strong start.
Elijah Thomas had a big week. Yeah.
I mean, just like rinse and repeat on that one. I did want to mention one of the kind of, you know, I go to games every week, obviously, but one of the ones I'd kind of earmarked early in the season that I'm pretty excited about, I'm going to Louisiana this weekend, going to go see Peyton Houston, Oklahoma's 2027 quarterback offer, a guy that we saw at camp, a guy that we've seen at some other camps kind of through the spring and summer. And again, he went up a couple weeks ago in their season opener against Monroe Neville, and they lost 42-24. I think Neville, of their four or five guys in their secondary, I think three of the four or four of the five have Power Five offers. So, like, his first start as a sophomore in high school, he's playing one of the best secondaries in the country. And from what I understand, he put up some pretty serious numbers. I haven't been able to find them exact, you know, I would list them if they were exact. But I'm very interested to see this game. It's my first time, actually. I'm going, they play at, was it Northwest Louisiana State or something like that? They're the Demons or something like that. Anyway, the last time I was in this stadium, I was watching Cody Ford as a high school senior. So kind of a wild walk back about 7 years later.
I think I legitimately remember when you went down there to see Cody Ford.
Mm-hmm. It's a beautiful campus. I remember that. That's the thing I remember. It's like there's a big lake as you're coming in. Like, it's a really nice little college town.
All right. Anything else recruiting-wise that you wanted to throw out there maybe that you hadn't addressed since Monday?
No. You know, there'll be a lot of people kind of asking, like, what's the visit list going to look like? And there's going to be a handful of guys. I would expect it mainly to be, like, regionally committed guys. You know, the Zane Rose, the Elijah Thomases, you know, that kind of thing. Next week, they're going to store it up, and it'll be – Tennessee's going to be really large. They're going to have a lot of guys there.
It's legitimately maybe the biggest game day weekend, and I know they've got to get through this weekend, but it could be the biggest game week slash weekend in Norman from a recruiting, the game, fan interest. It truly might be like 14, 15 years.
It's humongous. Like, it really is. It's a very, very big game. And I mean, they get the great fall with it being a night game, so there's more guys that can make it up there. You know, it makes it more accessible to players from around the country. So I think you're going to see a lot of guys. I will say one of the better notes that I think has come around through the network, our guy Chad Simmons had a story with Richard Wesley, one of the top defensive ends, not just in California, but in the country, a 2027 guy who is the teammate or was the teammate last year at Sierra Canyon in California of Eugene Brooks. And he listed Oklahoma as one of his top teams, mentioned the two things that stood out to me in the story were, first, he talked to Chad about the things that he was interested in. And he was like, you know, I want to connect with the coaches. I want to know they care about me. I want to have a real relationship. And then as he talks about the schools he's interested in, he talked about having a 30-minute conversation with Miguel Chavis and was like, we really talked. He talked to me about what drives me, what motivates me, you know, that kind of stuff. He goes, it felt like he cared. And I'm like, okay, if, you know, and again, I'm not saying every guy picks on the criteria he lays out, but it is a good start for Oklahoma. And again, I would expect him at some point or another to show up on campus.
Real quick before we get out of here, were you more impressed with Texas or how bad Michigan looked?
How bad Michigan looked. And that's not a hate on Texas. Michigan, guys, that's I mean, you want to talk about a team that doesn't have a lot of hope. Like Oklahoma, they need to get healthy. They need a little help here and there. But there is reason to believe in their talent. Michigan was clearly, and I mean clearly, built to run one kind of offense, and they've realized Alex Orji can't complete enough passes to run that offense. So now they're like, well, okay, but they've got no difference makers outside. They're running out receivers that I don't think Indiana would be jealous of. And so you're like, well, how are you going to run a pro-style offense with that sort of attack on the outside? And I love the tight end. Loveland's a really good kid. But, guys, the thing I was looking at was while we were talking earlier about OU's upcoming schedule and what it looks like, and, you know, George mentioned just Texas always being a chaotic game. Do you know Quinn Ewers is averaging like 6.8 yards per attempt or something like that? Guys, that's nothing. Like that is throwing to your running backs a lot and doing some of those stuff. And Sark can scheme up some amazing stuff. But I'm still not seeing, you know, I keep hearing about all this speed and speed and speed. And I'm like, that's great. But sooner or later, you're going to have to challenge downfield. And I don't think Michigan, I just don't think Michigan's as talented in the secondary as Oklahoma is. I just don't feel that way.
I think
they've got Will Johnson, and he's incredible, but that's about it.
I think OU can hang around in that game. And, of course, It's OU Texas. Like I said, you just never know.
You got the bye week before.
Yeah, I mean, and they can maybe get some guys back. Like, I think the Branson Hickman thing, like, his timeline, I would expect him to maybe be back for that. And you give him the bye week, maybe he can get healthy. So, I don't know, that's a ways down. I thought the college football weekend was just a kind of a strange one. Oregon struggled again, which I think
it's another team that can't run the football.
I think Boise State's a good football team, though. I will say that they've got maybe the best running back in the country. And then
there's that OSU hate.
what did Ollie Gordon do? And then
scored the winning touchdown, I believe.
Yeah, that's great. Good job. I think Notre Dame, that obviously took a lot of people by storm. It made me think the Notre Dame performance, Marcus Freeman, it's just so interesting. I feel like the national narrative around Marcus Freeman is this, like, he's just done a really good job there and they've all this stuff. But you look at...
He's lost to Marshall in Northern Illinois. And I like Marcus Freeman.
Yeah.
I think he's a really good coach.
Yeah,
but they've lost to Marshall in Northern Illinois now.
They seem to lay a lot of stinkers.
Or I guess two of the last 3 years.
And it made me think about that year. That was the same year Brent got hired. And I brought this up to you guys in the office. As you look at those coaches that were hired in that year, it was the end of the 2021 season.
How do you rank them?
And it was, you know, Marcus Freeman, Billy Napier, Dan Lanning, Brent Venables. I can't remember. I had the list somewhere, but there wasn't a lot.
Or Riley, back, Kelly.
Lincoln Riley, Brian Kelly. Like, I don't know how you would rank all those hires. I think a lot of people would say Dan Lanning number one, but what exactly has Oregon done? Yeah, they've won, you know, 10, 11 games.
It's kind of crazy that Lincoln Riley and Brian Kelly have both won Heisman trophies, like, or their teams have won Heisman trophies over that time.
I mean, the Brian Kelly experiment at LSU, I don't think it's going super well. Lincoln Riley, I think that USC maybe has a big year this year if they can maybe turn some things around. But Billy Napier, obviously, probably going to get fired. Marcus Freeman can't win.
What was the stat you told me this morning about A&M going out to Gainesville this weekend?
They haven't won a road SEC game since 2021.
It's crazy.
The longest like road losing streaks, it's like them, Temple, Kent State, and Akron or something. Like, you're like, good what company. The hell? How is this team even on that list?
That's wild. I would say that one of the most confusing teams to me is probably Kentucky. And maybe it's just that Brock Vandegrift is not that good of a quarterback. I mean, I said this to, I think I was talking to Eddie about this the other day. Like, Kentucky has always been, like, we understand Mark Stoops wants to control the ball. He wants to control the game. And they've always had a quarterback, even Will Levis, that was mobile, that was able to move the ball, pick up some short yardage here, extend some stuff. They're not like Georgia good on defense to where they can just have a drop back quarterback and expect to put up, you know, a whole lot of points that way.
That was surprising. It was really, I mean, really
good for Shane Beamer. He needed that win.
It was great for Shane. They're getting game day this weekend. It's kind of crazy.
Have you guys had a chance to watch that freshman they've got, the Dylan Stewart?
Yeah, kid? I just saw
he's
the kind
a monster. Of monster.
Well, get a first row seat to him here in about a month and a half.
But by the way, are you surprised at how average Riley Leonard has looked for Notre Dame, Josh?
Supposedly he's hurt. He has to be hurt.
Yeah. I mean, part of me wonders if Notre Dame was like, well, we can, you know, like, we'll run him out there against A&M, do what we got to do, and then we've got a pretty cush schedule for 3 or 4 weeks here, and we're just going to, we'll kind of pull the reins in. Like, almost to the point, like, I wondered, because you'd heard he was hurt kind of in the off season, and then, like, I almost wondered if they were going to start the Angeli guy that's their backup, that's more of like a drop back kind of traditional passer, and it didn't happen. And you wonder if, like, midway through the Northern Illinois game, they're like, well, we can't bench him. But at the same time, like, what do we do here? Because we're not getting it, like, we're not moving the ball like we need to. That's got to be one of the more shocking things. Because, I mean, can you, like, think how mad OU fans are right now? Flip it on the head. Like, you finally get over that game. You finally kind of clear that hurdle that everybody's been waiting for Notre Dame to do. So, okay, now you just, you know, it's all downhill to the playoff. Nope. Like, and you, I mean, guys, they might go 11-1 and not make the playoff with a loss that bad.
I mean, the way they played on Saturday, they might get beat by Miami of Ohio in 2 weeks, who was actually chosen to win the MAC this year.
I mean, I just find it so fascinating because this is really the first year that I can remember where we're, and it, you know, I guess DJU has failed, you know, essentially failed at Clemson, then, you know, ended up, he did okay at Oregon State, but it's like Riley Leonard, Connor Wegman, DJU. I'm trying to think of other quarterbacks that have kind of, maybe you could say Nussmeier at LSU, but I didn't really have high expectations of him to begin with. But like the NIL era, seeing what's happened with DJ Lagway and Graham Mertz, it's like, it's kind of heartwarming to see a quarterback get benched in this day and age when you know they're all making $1 million.
Get ready, because I believe that Billy Napier has said that Graham Mertz is back, baby. He's playing this weekend.
But I think he also said that with Lagway. DJ's taking all the number one reps, though, right? So he came out and said that
Mertz he didn't say starting. That he was starting. He said they both play, which
he,
I think
he said just, on the – I listened to his teleconference today.
I think
today,
it's incredible.
And he said that Lagway and Mertz have been basically splitting first team reps in practice.
They should fire him on the spot.
Yeah.
If he sends Graham Mertz out there to start the game, he's done. He should be done.
DJ Lagway's the reason why you even have any chance of staying next year in 2025.
You've got to sell them that hope.
Right.
This is our guy. He's going to lead us the next 2 years, and we're going to be better.
And it's a shitty situation for Graham Mertz, but kind of is what it is.
Any games pique your guys' interest this weekend?
Boston College, Missouri.
That's not one.
So much because I think that they're going to go lose. I just kind of want to see how Alabama bounces back going on the road to Madison this weekend.
God, they did not look good until the last few minutes of that game.
I don't think Wisconsin's any good.
No.
But it is still somewhat of a, like the Friday night game, Arizona, K-State.
I think that might be the best
game
of the weekend.
Interesting. LSU, South Carolina, I guess just because South Carolina, are they trying to turn a corner that nobody thought that they were worth a shit this year? OU and Oregon, just to see, like, can they get out of this rut in a way? Like,
who does Oregon play?
Oregon State, Civil War this weekend.
Oh.
In Corvallis at Research Stadium. I don't know, though. I think that's about it. It seems like a light weekend.
I'm going to tell you, the funnest game all week is Thursday night.
Yeah,
Texas State and Arizona State, they may score 70 points. That's going to be a ton of fun to watch.
I don't know.
The party
pull up your Prize Picks app, because I don't know what the line is, but I'm going over on Scatty Boo if I can select yardage.
Oh, Arizona State kid.
Scatty Boo is like my favorite player, and he has been in football for a while, but I can't believe he's a senior finally. I mean, like, but late night Scatty Boo, like we had that last week. That was the only game I think that was the last game that was played
mm-hmm.
of the
yeah,
night.
Yeah,
it was.
But I was, these guys will tell you, I was just in the other room just screaming, Scatty Boo! I mean, like, I love that kid.
We get another good late night one with Colorado and Colorado State. I'm sure there'll be some fireworks.
Yeah, they keep shoving that down our throats. Is Colorado State's not any good?
No, they're not any good.
No, I don't think Colorado's any good either.
Yeah, that's true.
It's going to be, well, remember last year, such a great game.
Yeah.
It was two crappy teams. Yeah.
I just kind of want to see the interaction between.
That's a 6:30 start. Deion
and Jay Norvell.
They're labeling the who?
Colorado State.
Oh, on Saturday?
The late game is.
I thought that was the late game.
No, BYU Wyoming's at 8. Houston Rice is at 7. The latest game is New Mexico State and Fresno State at 9:30.
What time is Colorado?
That's sad.
Colorado 6:00.
Oh.
6:30 on CBS.
Josh, I'm all in on Thursday night too. The Party Bowl is going to be amazing. Two great party schools.
That should just be a battle where both presidents agree they are not having school on Friday. Whoever wins does not have class on Friday.
I don't think they have to make that announcement, because I don't think that there's a whole lot of Texas State and Arizona State students that are going to class on
Friday. Did you see Friday night's lineup this week?
Yeah, it's great. Kansas State.
Awesome. Kansas State, UNLV.
Arizona. Yeah, Kansas State and Arizona. That's interesting.
My dad, go
UNLV.
But Arizona State's Thursday, so we could see Scataboo on Thursday night. Awesome.
Right.
My mom and dad are driving to Manhattan, Kansas. So my cousin is the tight ends coach at Kansas State.
Oh, they're going to the game.
They're going to the game Friday night, and then they're driving back. They're driving straight from Manhattan Saturday morning to go to the OU game.
Cool.
That's an awesome weekend. Yeah.
That is. You guys enjoy that Arizona Kansas State game. I will not get to watch it, and I just realized it's a Friday night game, and I'm now pissed. So that's disappointing. I'll be
man,
in.
Man, that's a hell of a game.
Natchitoches, Louisiana.
On Fox too. That's strange. The baseball this time of year.
Well, they're doing that the Friday night thing. That's a new thing.
Is that a new thing?
Big 12's playing every Friday.
Okay.
Memphis, Florida State. I'm not interested in it. I just kind of want Memphis to win to really set this thing off.
That'd be
awesome. Those people will lose their.
Is Memphis any good? I think
they're.
Yeah.
Florida State's a 6.5-point favorite.
They're a legit playoff, like the G5 playoff contender. They've got to do that.
Okay.
If they could get this win, that would mean a lot.
Oh, Reggie Grimes plays for Memphis, right?
Yeah.
Yes, that's correct.
Oh, that's right.
Maybe he'll sack DJU.
Yeah, that's going to be a snake pit. I mean, Mike Norvell going back there.
And it's at, like, I think noon out there. It's at 11 a.m. Nobody's going to want to be there.
Or is this in Memphis or is it in
It's in Tallahassee.
Okay.
Also, I'm sure we're wrapping up here soon, but just a little NFL talk. Baker Mayfield, MVP.
He looked great.
Good to see that.
He looked great.
It was awesome.
Washington's defense is terrible, but it's clear he's got the right offensive coordinator for his type of game.
Yeah.
Which is good to see.
Did you hear the Cleveland radio?
Oh, yeah. It was glorious. First caller out of the gate.
So good on Monday, too.
We're going to do this. We're going to do this now.
Hey, I mean, the NFL might save the Browns. They might get. I saw the report yesterday that because it happened back when he was in Houston, that he was already suspended. But since this is a new case, even though it happened back when all that other stuff happened, his contract only stipulated that he couldn't lose salary if he was suspended for the 22 and 23 seasons.
Yeah, I think so.
So if he gets suspended for the 24 season for any amount of time, they can basically get out of this.
That's crazy. I hope that doesn't happen. I want Cleveland.
They should have to suffer.
Yeah, that is unbelievable.
They knew what they were doing.
What a horrible organization.
Get out of that.
I mean, the fact that they couldn't realize, like, oh, he hasn't played for a while, maybe he's lost it a little bit. They just assumed that they were going to get the best version of Deshaun Watson after going through all of that stuff, and he's a shell of him of his former self as a football player.
He's awful. I think PFT
they want to start Jameis Winston over.
PFT said it best. He's all of a sudden become a better human than he is a quarterback. it kind of is true.
Yeah.
Hope PFT's hair transplant went well. All right. Anything else you guys want to throw out there before we get out of here?
No. Just in terms of college baseball stuff, I don't know if anybody wants to hear that in the beginning of September, but I do expect the schedule to come out on Thursday when you're listening to this. And the two series that I'm pretty positive are going to be in Norman is LSU and Texas. That's for sure. Wow, I don't think that Arkansas is awesome on the schedule, which kind of sucks. But it'll be kind of interesting to get the SEC baseball schedule.
Yeah, that'll be cool to see. By the way, Home Field doing pop-ups this weekend. Homefieldapparel.com, a great sponsor of a lot of our shows on YouTube. But Thursday night, Eddie George and I will be at the Standard on Gray Street here in Norman. But from 4 to 7, if you wear your Home Field gear, you get free drinks. If you buy anything, you get some free drinks. So they'll have a pop-up shop. Might have some of that cool stuff they're sold out of online. Then Friday night, Coach's Corner, the new place that used to be Penny Hill, used to be Toby Keith's Bar and Grill, used to be Texadelphia there on the corner of Lindsay and Barry. And then Saturday morning, they're going to have a brunch pop-up over at the Noun Hotel, fantastic hotel, just right down the street from us here on Campus Corner on the end, basically the west end of White Street is the Noun Hotel. And you really can't miss it if you get down to campus. So we'll be there Thursday. Love to have you come out and see us and, talk some football and drink some beers and get some home field merch. So looking forward to that. All right, that's going to do it for us. We'll be back again next week for another edition of the Unofficial 40 Podcast right here on Soonerscoop.com.